Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the 10th episode of the ICER Mohali Public Engagement Series of Talks. Today, we have Dr. Rajesh Ramachandran as our speaker. And like always, this talk will be for about 45 minutes or so. And you are welcome to ask questions at the end of the talk. All my colleagues who are on Zoom, at the end of the talk, you can raise your hand and we'll let you ask your question. All our colleagues who are watching this on YouTube, please type in your questions in the chat and we'll pick up the questions from there and ask those questions for you. Okay, Dr. Rajesh, he did something very interesting for his master's. He studied marine biology at Cochin University, very different from what most people end up doing. And after doing his master's in marine biology, he went to the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology at Hyderabad for his PhD. And after getting his PhD from CCMB Hyderabad, he then went on to do two postdocs, one at CCMB itself and other in the Molecular and Behavioral Neuroscience Institute at the University of Michigan at USA. And he has been at ICER Mohali since 2012. He is interested in a wide range of issues, most importantly in the issues of regeneration. And he uses this fantastic model system of zebrafish. And I also know now he has a very interesting organism in his lab, the axolotl larva. We are all excited about it, right? So he's going to talk to us today about regeneration in general, using zebrafish as a model in particular. Dr. Rajesh.
Thanks. Thanks, Professor Prasad, and also others involved who gave me the opportunity to present. And special thanks to Professor Prasad for the kind introduction. And without wasting too much of time, I will proceed with my today's talk. So the title of today's talk is Retina Regeneration and Lessons from Zebrafish. So as the name itself indicates that we were trying to learn how zebrafish is performing the regeneration when there is a damage in the tissue. We know that in our lifetime, we end up getting several types of trauma and tissue damage, etc., occurring. And we repair, our body is capable of repairing it quite efficiently, and without which you end up getting your body full of bruises and wounds, because that never happened, we repair it. However, when it comes to complex organ, not just the skin, hair, or nail, or something like that, when it comes to complex organs such as, say, brain, spinal cord, heart, kidney, etc., we fail. Normally, the mammals are incapable of repairing those organs. So we have to understand that some organisms will be able to repair these complex organs as well. One such organism is zebrafish. Now, before going into the detail, let us try to understand what is regeneration all about. So regeneration is a somewhat similar mechanism like if we can bring in an analogy. Let us assume a wall or a floor that is made of different types of tiles. So they are nothing but different cells of a tissue. So whenever there is an insult that occurs, as it happened here, whenever an insult occurs, then one tile is broken or a group of tile is broken. So we don't want such a situation to happen. So we would like to repair it. So one option is just to put some cement, which is, or some color, which is matching quite to that of these tiles, and fix, the damaged portion is covered and it is quite okay to use now. This is a typical wound healing. That is what happens whenever you get a cut or any other damage happens in your tissue. We call this as wound healing, that is healing of a wound. But when you talk about regeneration, It is replacing with the exact same tile. So that is called regeneration. So by and large, you know, the regeneration is slightly different from wound healing in the sense that the restoration to normalcy is almost complete, unlike filling the gap with some kind of cells. That means the damaged organ is restoring the normalcy and functional retain it. It can retain the functionality of that organ or a tissue. So now let us see, how do we study? We know that there are five major vertebrate groups are there, starting from fishes and frogs or salamanders like axolotl, newt, and then birds, and then mice, which is mammal. So you have fish, you have frog, and then there is a middle group which we can put here, but we don't use it as a model. That is reptiles, that is lizards, snakes, etc. They are also part of vertebrate group. And then comes the birds, and then comes the mammal. But reptiles are not usually used for regeneration biology studies. First, they are limited in their capacity. And second, it is very difficult to manage them as a model organism in lab conditions. So people often use zebrafish and axolotl, newt, and chicken, and mice. But it is important to note that although fishes and the salamanders have extreme regenerative capacity, chicken and mice are often very limited, and it is limited to their very early, like neonatal stage, or you know, soon after the birth, after a few days, they lose their capacity. So, but still, since they are advanced vertebrates, people use them to study different types of regeneration or tissue damage and their post-damage response to a injury. So people use it. Researchers find lots of major important pathways. So in my today's talk, it can be broadly classified into first a background, and then we would address quickly the importance of a few of the pathway, that is sonic hedgehog signaling and histone deacetylases importance, and a few of the pluripotency inducing factors, and also another pathway involving transformation growth factor beta. It may sound a little mouthful, but I will try my best to make it as light as possible. But without addressing the real scientific topic, it is very difficult for me to convey in a nice manner. So we will address how these molecules are implicated in a regeneration of the retina. So a lot of organs can regenerate in zebrafish, but our focus is mainly on the retina. So there is a reason why we focus on the retina. Retina is the part of the central nervous system. Central nervous system involves the brain and spinal cord. So retina regeneration is very important because around 5% of the world population often face some or the other troubles related to the retina during their lifetime. And a few of them are listed here: retinitis pigmentosa, macular degeneration, chondrodystrophy. I will not go into the details. Some of them are genetic and some of them are a physiological condition, like diabetic retinopathy, retinal detachment or glaucoma. These are all occurring, need not be because of a genetic damage, rather it is a condition arising because of other underlying disease conditions such as diabetes. So all these major retinal problems are resulting in irreversible blindness, because if you get a damage to your cornea, that is front part of the eye, you can repair it if you get a donor cornea, but retinal damage is impossible to fix it. Hence, it deserves to be addressed in a much detailed manner. So what are the possible solutions one can think of? That is gene therapy, stem cell therapy, electrode transplantation. So these are all some approach people do it. Gene therapy is replacing the damaged gene, and stem cell therapy is the supplementing with stem cells in the site of injury. And then electrode transplantation is a method in which you can implant tiny electrodes in that place where the image is formed. Image is formed with the help of lens and the cornea. That image will be converted into electrical signals, and your optic neuron will pass on the message to the brain. But this is not a typical vision, but rather they can get some support, whether an object is coming towards them or not. They can avoid bumping onto some objects. That's all, because it cannot be called as a typical vision. So regeneration of the retina, if we can understand how it is happening from the existing retinal cells itself, because whenever there is a damage, it doesn't happen to the entire retina. It happens quite locally, which to start with. That time itself, if there is a way, we can understand how this damage can be curbed. That is the best way one could think of fixing this retinal problem. So one has to understand the mechanism of regeneration using various animal models, because as we all know, no one can do research in using human as a organism, because it is not allowed any part of the world, rather it is not ethical. So we use various mammalian, avian, amphibian and fish models. And as I already told you, mammalian and avian means birds, they are limited and restricted to their embryonic stage or post-embryonic stage, first few days of their birth. Whereas amphibians and fish models have extreme capability of regenerating almost any organ that is present in their body. So why zebrafish? What is the relevance of zebrafish? Because it can reproduce year-round. It has got external fertilization. It has got transparent embryos. And embryos can be injected with the DNA, RNA. And also zebrafish is amenable for large-scale genetic screens. But these are all some of the important points. But the most important point is zebrafish and humans share extensive genomic homology and synteny. This is very important, because if zebrafish is performing its regeneration because of some unique genes, it has got some 10 genes or 50 genes or 100 genes that is unique to this animal. And then if it is regenerating, there is no point in pursuing further, because those genes are missing in mammal. But that is not the case. We have same set of genes what a zebrafish also has. And not only that, the way in which they are arranged also, to a significant extent, it is the same. So that holds promise that zebrafish is capable of regenerating. That means there is a way in which we can also, or the mammalian species also, can modify its genome or whatever is required to help ourselves in getting a regeneration happening, at least as good as a model organism. And zebrafish can regenerate the central nervous system neurons. CNS stands for central nervous system, following a damage. Central nervous system means, because our nervous system is one of the major complex organ that guides the functioning of the entire organism. Brain and spinal cord forms the central nervous system, and associated organs like eye, nose, etc. also come under the central nervous system. So zebrafish can regenerate central nervous system neurons. And the other nervous system is the peripheral nervous system that even mammals can regenerate. That is much meager, like they are more of sensory in nature, less of motor in function. Hence, it is quite less significant compared to the central nervous system for an organism point of view. So if you look into the structure of the zebrafish retina, you can see it has got a cup-like structure, or like a spherical ball-like structure. What you see in the front, which is dark blue, is the cornea. What you see in this greenish blue is the lens itself. And this yellow colored one is the retina. And then far behind is the supporting layers, that is choroid layers, etc. I will not go into the details. And this is the optic nerve itself, that is going, all this message that is collected in the retina is going in the form of electrical impulse back into the brain, and where it is processed and you end up getting a feeling of the vision. So if you look into the ultrastructure of the retina has got three major layers. One is outer nuclear layer, then inner nuclear layer, and a ganglion cell layer. The outer nuclear layer has got this photoreceptors. That means whatever light that is coming from here, that is from outside through the lens, and it is going all the way into the retina. And that is sensed by the rods and cones. Cones are meant for bright light vision as well as color vision. Rods are meant for dim light vision as well as black and white vision. So these are abundantly present in the outer nuclear layer. And then the inner nuclear layer, you have got horizontal cells, amacrine cells, bipolar cells, and the Müller glia cell itself. So Müller glia is a cell that is supportive in function. That is not a neuron. It's a glial cell. But what is the role of glia is to help these neurons like rods, cones, horizontal, bipolar, amacrine cells perform their function normally. And then comes the ganglion cell layer where this information that is gathered in the photoreceptor layer is converted into electrical signal through bipolar cell, and also ganglion cell receives it. And this axon that is joining into the optic nerve, what you can see here, and that individual ganglion cell layer give rise to one axon and pass on the information. So that's how the image is processed in the brain. So this Müller glial cell that can stretch across all the three layers, outer nuclear layer, inner nuclear layer, and ganglion cell layer. It is one of the largest cells, and it has a much complex structure, and it can wrap around its cytoplasm. It's a cell can wrap around other cells and as part of providing this structural and functional support. And it is very important because this Müller glia is the one which is going to contribute to the regeneration. So to study regeneration, we need to perform a damage, because you have to take a healthy eye and then you have to cause a poke using a 30 gauge needle from the back of the eye. So usually we give around 4 pokes from the back of the eye, and which is very easy to perform. And the undamaged surrounding area can act as a very good control for doing any studies or any observation. But this injury will be done under anesthetized deep anesthetic condition. So the fish is not going to suffer much because of this poke. So to study the regeneration, we need to have some transgenic animal. So one such animal we use is a tubulin promoter. Tubulin is a cytoskeletal protein of the neurons. And tubulin promoter is a fragment that is driving a reporter called GFP, green fluorescent protein. And as you can see here, this this fish is called a tuba-1 GFP fish that lights up in the central nervous system. You can see this is the brain, spinal cord, and the retina. You can see this is the eye, and even retina lights up. And if you take the retina cross section in an uninjured same fish uninjured, you will not see any green fluorescence expression. Although it is expressed in the central nervous system, in the retina of an adult, you simply do not see any GFP expression. However, if you injure it, like I told you, using a 30 gauge needle, if you injure it, you end up getting a lot of GFP positive cells, and which are BRDU positive also. BRDU positive means the cells which are undergoing cellular proliferation. So if you want to mark a cell which undergoes proliferation, we can stain them with BRDU while the proliferation is going on. And we can see these proliferating cells are the ones which express the GFP. So in this way, we can use this animal model, zebrafish transgenic animal, to mark those cells that enter the cell cycle soon after an injury. So, and one more thing I want to keep you interested in is that soon after injury, like 1 day, 3 day, 5 day, 7 day, different days, if you keep counting this BRDU cell, we see 4 day is around peak of proliferation, cellular proliferation. That means that is the time you get maximum number of proliferating cells which exhibit stem cell characteristics. And now, how do we know whether these are, I told you that they are derived from the Müller glia. So this GFP positive one cell collabs with a marker protein. Marker protein is that molecule that is giving identity to a cell. Every cell, although they look the same, they are not the same internally. They have got some marker, and we call them as marker protein. And GS stands for glutamine synthetase. This is an enzyme that is present specifically in the retinal Müller glia. And they are expressed, co-expressed. And hence, we can assume that these GFP positive ones are indeed derived from this Müller glial cell. So now let us see what's happening soon after an injury. Soon after an injury, this is an intact retina. You have an outer nuclear layer, inner nuclear layer, and ganglion cell layer. Soon after injury, what happened? This Müller glia starts secreting some of these factors or some of this regeneration facilitating molecules, because of which there will be an expansion in number. This is called cellular proliferation. And these proliferated cells, now they migrate to different layers and differentiate back. So what happens? Retina, it gets, after injury, the retina has got dedifferentiated or activated neural glia, and they increase in number, and then they differentiate back, not only into Müller glia, but also into other retinal cell types. So we can call these proliferated cells are exhibiting characters of stem cells. So, but it is important to understand what are these genetic factors, how precisely they are controlling this dedifferentiation or reprogramming, then proliferation, and then redifferentiation. So, you know, few years ago, I think in 2006, Nobel Prize was given for the discovery of pluripotency inducing factors. They are of two types, Yamanaka factors and Thompson factors. And what it says that a group of these four, OCT4, SOX2, KLF, c-MYC, or OCT4, SOX2, NANO, GLIN28, these can, either any four of them, if you express in a fibroblast cell. So fibroblast cells are the normal cell that is covering your skin, etc. Like they are kind of a stuffer cells. You can express these factors in them and convert them into stem cells. So that was a path-breaking discovery. But this knowledge was there for a few years, but nobody knew what does the retina or zebrafish retina adopt the same strategy or not. But what we found after a few years of this initial iPSC factors, we found that my earlier study at the University of Michigan, we found that all the six of them, four here and four here, and four plus, and because two of them are common, like OCT4 and SOX2 are common, and KLF c-MYC is here, and NANOC and LIN28 is here. All six of them are induced in the retina without any external influence. So hence, one could assume that these Müller glia, which is reprogramming, are acting exactly like iPS cells. So we did some more experiments. So you may remember this, just now I showed you that this is the GFP positive cells, and you can isolate them and you can collect them using a cell sorter, like a fluorescence activated cell sorter, and you just deliver them into a more or less developing embryo. So a normal wild type embryo will not have any of the fluorescence, but once you transfer it, these cells, these GFP positive cells, can get integrated into the different cell types or different body parts. That indicates these are derived from the stem cell, derived from the retina, exhibiting stem cell characteristics, but they can participate in the embryogenesis also. So this suggests that these cells indeed are acting like iPS cells. And keep in mind that no external influence is being done except an injury. So we should understand the Müller glia is now getting converted itself into a Müller glia derived progenitors, which has all the stem cell characteristics. But how these are influenced? Although Müller glia getting converted, but who is influencing, or what factors are influencing the Müller glia? And a few of them are listed here: Wnt signaling, FGF, MAP kinase, and IGF and HBGF. Some of these are listed here. Those who are interested can read this review. And we should also understand some of this EGF pathway and some pathway such as delta notch signaling, they can influence in a different manner. That is, this symbol indicates it can negatively influence. So some factors will be stimulating. Say, for example, for regeneration, if you need 100 cells, let us assume. But if there is only a forward factor, only stimulating factor, instead of 100, you end up getting 1,000 cells. You don't want that. You want only 100, and if not, maximum 200. So some anti or some opposite action also is necessary. And such an action is done by delta notch signaling. And there are other factors also. There are other transcription factors or pluripotency factors such as LIN28. And then there is a proneural gene, which is called ASCL1A. They are stimulators of the Müller glia derived progenitor cell. And then there is a transcriptional repressor called INSM1A, which is initially isolated from insulinoma, a cancer. But it is a transcriptional repressor that is regulating the expression of these factors. So it's a complex process. It is not easy. So my subsequent talk will be orienting more towards the Lin28, ASCL1A, etc. And then lastly, I would like to bring into your attention to a microRNA that is called LET7 microRNA, which is present in every differentiated cell, and its role is to block any unwanted cell proliferation. So cell proliferation can happen if there is a induction of pluripotency factors. So you don't want any unwanted proliferation. Your neurons don't want to be divided unnecessarily. So they make sure that a differentiated cell remains differentiated. So do not allow any such reprogramming to happen. So a typical in situ hybridization, this is an in situ of Lin28. This is the retina, this is the pigment epithelium. Like when you see through the eye of a person, you see it black in color, especially through the center, especially because of the retinal pigment epithelium. And this is the retinal layer, outer nuclear layer, then the inner nuclear layer, then the ganglion cell layer. So this is the site of injury where the needle is gone through like this, this way. You start from here and poke all the way into the center of the eye. And this is the place where the Lin28 is expressed. And you often show a box. So in subsequent pictures, you will see a box like this, which is part of the retina, but you cannot show this entire eye, but you rather show a small block. And so what Lin28 does? Lin28 is one of the 6 pluripotency factors. Its role is to block this LET7. So for regeneration to happen, you want to get rid of the LET7 first. So the Lin28 blocks the LET7 microRNA when it is expressed at first. So it is one of the pluripotency factors expressed in embryonic stem cells and cancer cells. Lin28 is found both in the nucleus and cytoplasm to regulate the LET7 microRNA levels. How does it do? So LET7 has its own gene, and it is expressed in the form of pre-LET7. And then Lin28 can block the conversion, further maturation of the Lin28, because that is usually done by 2 factors like DROSHA and DGCR8. Lin28 can block it. And this is further exported into the cytoplasm by a protein called exportin. And this, what it will do is it can block, this further maturation is done by a protein called DICER. And this is the actual player of LET7. So Lin28 can block that also. So Lin28 blocks the LET7, and Lin28 also blocks the maturation of the exporting. So it can act both in nucleus as well as cytoplasm. So the net result is it will stop the presence, or it will remove the LET7 microRNA, and that will facilitate the reprogramming. So in a typical case, LET7 microRNA is supposed to facilitate differentiation. So then, like I told this, I told you already that these pluripotency factors are induced. And interesting to note that all these pluripotency factors, including the ASCL1A, which is not a pluripotency factor, but an essential factor for regeneration, that is negatively regulated by the LET7 microRNA. So keep in mind, these microRNAs always block the translation of a given set of mRNAs, provided this microRNA have got their binding site on this mRNA. So almost all of them, like PAX6 and CMYC, OCT4, quite a lot of them are there, and majority of them are blocked by LET7 microRNA. As you increase the dose of the LET7 microRNA, you decrease the translatability of this protein. And that is what, this is the Western blotting. And this is where the band is expressed strong, and quite a lot of, and it can, interesting to note that it can block Lin28 itself. So that means it's a kind of a yin-yang relationship, like Lin28 block LET7, LET7 can block Lin28 also. So now let us move on to the importance of blockade of an important pathway called sonic hedgehog signaling. Sonic hedgehog signaling is an important pathway that is governing the normal development of an organism. Say this is a normal zebrafish, which is not been, it has been normally treated with the DMSO as a control. And this is the ventral view. Ventral view is basically like your chest, face, etc. is the ventral view. Your backside is your dorsal view. So this is the ventral view. You can see the normal eye that is developed. But if you block the hedgehog signaling, you prevent the separation of the eye. Rather, eyes remain fused and they stay together. And we tested it to show whether cyclopamine, or if you block the hedgehog signaling has an impact at all or not in the zebrafish development. And same mechanism happens in humans as well as in mammals, because the cyclopamine is produced in a initially isolated from some lily plant, that is Californian lily. If the pregnant mother consumes those plants, like goats will eat those grass, right? If they consume during their pregnant stage, the young ones that is formed will be of cyclopia. Normally, they don't survive. They die soon after birth. So the percentage of cyclopia embryo was quite high in a dose-dependent manner. And we know that this developmental pathway, similar to what is seen in mammals, it is very important in zebrafish also. So now let us see what this pathway is doing all about. So this is the cell membrane, and this hedgehog signaling or sonic hedgehog signaling pathway has got two stages. And this is one receptor, we call it as a patched receptor, and then there is a second receptor called smooth end. So what is the role of this patched receptor is to block smooth end any given time. But the moment the SHS ligand comes and binds onto the patched, what happens? It is no longer able to block. And if it is not blocked, what happens? This smooth end receptor will be able to do its job, that is continuing to the downstream pathway such as glee protein activation, etc. But what the cyclopamine will do, cyclopamine will prevent the migration of this receptor, smooth end receptor. So net result, what will happen? There will not be hedgehog signaling at all, because patched only will be there on the surface, but patched cannot do any function. All their role is to bind with the hedgehog. So the smooth end is the actual player. So cyclopamine blocks it. So hence no hedgehog signaling is possible. So that is what in general about this pathway. So the cyclopamine mediated some of the major pathways during regeneration. So since it is important to be during the development of zebrafish, we looked whether is it playing any role during the regeneration, because we know during development also there is a lot of pluripotency inducing factors are induced, and also stem cells are involved. And we also showed that the retinal progenitors are contributing to the embryogenesis also. So hence what we did, we exposed the injured retina. This is the BRDU positive or the proliferating cell. And we just treated with two different concentrations. We saw we can significantly reduce. So that indicated that the regeneration has something in common to that of the development itself, or this pathway is important for the stem cell induction. If there are no stem cell or there is no progenitors, there is no question of regeneration. So another important step we do in our lab is to take a zebrafish, anesthetize it, and deliver chemicals or morpholino or anything, any molecule. Morpholino is a new term I'm introducing. It is a molecule that is used for blocking the translatability. Say there are 100 genes. You want to block only one gene. So you can use a morpholino against that RNA or that gene, and that will go and block the translatability. Hence, RNA will be there, but protein will not be there in the system. Hence, that gene cannot do its normal function. So this morpholino is delivered into the vitreous. So this is the lens, and this is the vitreous cavity, what you see in the white color. And morpholino usually are labeled with a fluorophore called lysamine, so that you can monitor them under a microscope. And then you give an electric shock. As a result, from the vitreous, it will now enter into the retina. Randomly, this entering is not guided. It randomly enters every cell type. And then before harvesting, you can give a BRDU pulse to label the proliferating cell and harvest whenever you want. And this harvested retina can be sectioned, and you can do immunostaining in situ, etc. This is the workflow. So what we did, we delivered the retina with the control morpholino, means it do not have any target, and then sonic hedgehog A, because zebrafish has got two of them, SHHA and SHHB. And when you deliver them, what you see, you can see the red color, which is nothing but lysamine fluorescence. And in control morpholino, regeneration is normal. And in whereas, if you get rid of SHHA, you significantly reduce the proliferation. But on the other hand, if you deliver, supplement it, SHHA morpholino with SHH protein, it is rescuing this phenotype. And it means the effect was not due to some other feature, but rather it was because of SHH protein only. That is why its replenishment helped it. And now coming back to the Linton DAID, we should when we looked into the binding sites for the downstream players of the sonic hedgehog signaling, that is called a glee protein. So sonic hedgehog signaling, when it is turned on, you have to produce, or the system produce, lot of glee proteins. And these proteins bind on the targets and they turn on a lot of the genes. And Linton DAID is one of such a gene whose promoter had glee binding site. So because of the hedgehog signaling, you can get the Linton DAID turned on, which is helpful in removing the LET7 microRNA. And this is confirmed by chromatin immunoprecipitation. I will not go into the details. And one more important thing we should understand, this SHH protein, like we knocked it down earlier, that is quite interesting. In an uninjured retina, that is no injury has been given, you don't have any proliferation or you don't have any significant SHH or sonic hedgehog ligand expression. But after injury, you can see these are the proliferating cell as marked by the BRDU. They have SHHA expression. And this has got some relevance, and I will show you, because LET7 microRNA in control condition, the LET7 microRNA is present uniformly in the inner nuclear layer and also in the ganglion layer, and no proliferation happens. But in this proliferating cell, you may remember that here these are the proliferating cells, and these proliferating cells do not have LET7 microRNA because of the induction of the Linton DAID. And we further prove that not only the role of LET7 is not only to regulate some of the pluripotency factors, we also showed that quite a lot of these LET7 microRNA can influence the translatability of a lot of hedgehog signaling components itself, like such as SHHA, SHHB, and PAST and SMO receptor, because they also have the presence of, because what we do is we take these clones, these constructs, and they transfect them in cell lines, and then you have a reporter, and then the microRNA binding sequence, which is LET7 microRNA binding sequence from those genes, these genes. We have fused it, and then you harvest them and do a Western blotting assay. What we found, in a dose-dependent manner, you can see a decrease in the translatability of this GFP fused SHHA, SHHB, because we have to fuse with the GFP because we don't have antibody against each of this molecule. And plus, consistency of Western blotting also is ensured by the GFP in situ. But LET7 can act on the fused part. And as a result, you end up getting a decreased levels. And this is confirmed in a in vitro assay, but what has been shown here. So to summarize this part, we know SHHA bind down to the patch, and patch normally inhibits SMO, and SMO stimulates the glee, and glee indeed activates the Linton DAID, and the LET7 microRNA can stop. So Linton DAID and LET7 interaction, like Linton DAID blocks LET7, LET7 blocks Linton DAID, becomes quite crucial. So the induction of Linton DAID is very important. And this cyclopamine is meant for blocking the availability or the transport of SMO into the cytoplasm itself. So we'll keep adding onto the summary in the subsequent slides. So this study is published a few years ago. You can, those who are interested can read this paper. Then comes another epigenetic modifier called HDAC1, which is histone deacetylase. So this molecule was quite interesting, which is in the sense, it is induced soon after injury, and even the RNA in situ also shows that it is expressed close to the proliferating cell, which is the BRDU or PCNA positive cells. But when you look closely, when you do an immunostaining, you can see this HDAC is missing. It is literally missing. Like you can see dark color, which is a proliferating cell. And here also you can see a dark color, which is a proliferating cell, which made us a little curious what this molecule might be doing it. And also when you knock them down, although it is going off, but if you knock them down using morpholino, we see a dose dependent decrease. And this was quite hard for us to explain, that normally it is going off from the proliferating cell, but when you knock them down, it is further decreasing the proliferation. So it was kind of, but we found something very interesting, that when you block the histone deacetylase activity using drug like valproic acid or tricostatin A, we saw an increase in the LET7 microRNA levels. So this was quite interesting and we probed further. So what this might be contributing to it. We found that this molecule HDAC is probably is influencing the LINTONE D8 expression. And we will revisit this once again along with the subsequent part. So, but in this pathway, we should know the HDAC comes in here and it can influence the LINTONE D8 expression. And those more details can be seen in this paper. I will not go each and every part of this, but I just wanted to bring this LINTONE D8 part. So another important factor that is working in collaboration with HDAC is the MYC, which is a proto-oncogene, which is turned on in a lot of cancerous conditions. So what happens is this MYC genes are induced soon after injury. So this is an uninjured condition, and this is a graph of real-time PCR of the same MYC gene. MYC gene are of two types, MYC-A and MYC-B. And MYC-B is playing a major role during regeneration. And you can see soon after injury, within half an hour, this is 1 hour, this is 15 hours, this is 24 hours, this is 48 hours. Like that, if you can see soon after injury, it is induced heavily. And later on, although it stays induced, but it is early stage is much, much high. So this suggested possibly it is contributing to the reprogramming. So what we did, when you try to knock it down or when you try to block it, we did both things using a drug as well as using morpholino. We see the MYC max blocker. So MYC has a collaborator called max without which the protein is normally functional. So when you use this drug, you saw a dose-dependent decrease in the number of proliferating cells, suggesting that this early induction of MYC indeed is very important. And most important thing is that MYC, when you see, this is the in situ hybridization along with the LINTONE D8, and this is the proliferation marker BRDU, we can see a good number of these cells have both MYC and LINTONE D8 together. And it's also important to note that some of this proliferating cell, which is here, which is positive for MYC, green color, but it is not positive for LINTONE D8, some of them, not all of them. So when you look into the promoter of the LINTONE D8, we saw the MYC binding site, and we also confirmed by a chromatin immunoprecipitation that this site is functional and the MYC indeed bind onto the LINTONE D8 promoter to stimulate it. But that is not the end of the story. There are more to come because the same site can be occupied by the HDAC also. So now, if MYC and HDAC is occupying the same site, and there are also scientific published reports are available to show that MYC can collaborate with HDAC to cause a negative impact. Negative impact means it can downregulate. It can downregulate the expression of LINTONE D8. So coming back to our immunostain, earlier we reported the HDAC goes off from the proliferating cell. We should understand that if HDAC is missing, the MYC will be able to stimulate the LINTONE D8 expression. But if HDAC is present, it will cause the negative regulation of the LINTONE D8 promoter. That is why when you treat them with drugs like valproic acid or tricostatin A that is meant to block HDAC1, we saw an increase in the LET7 microRNA, because the LET7 microRNA are increased when the LINTONE D8 goes off, because there is no one to block the LINTONE D8. Because of that, LET7 microRNA goes up and that will prevent the proliferation. That is why the increased LET7 microRNA is the culprit that is contributing to the negative proliferation or the reduced proliferation in the HDAC1 blocked scenario. So now you can see here, the HDAC and MYC together can influence the LINTONE D8 expression. And so those details can be seen in this publication, which we published a few years ago, which talks about the dual regulation of LINTONE D8 via MYC and HDAC. And then another interesting molecule of the pluripotency factor, this is OCT4 or POU5F3. Both are same. It has got two names. So soon after injury, the OCT4 is induced very high levels. This is the qPCR or RT-PCR of OCT4. And then it stays high at 2 day and 4 day and 7 day. It stays high. And the regeneration completes by around 21 days in the retina with a needle poke. And this is the Western blot that also shows that OCT4 level is high and it remains high. By 4 day, there is another one more peak also. But this is a control, doesn't have too much of a change. But one important thing I want to point out here is that in mammals, in the retina of mouse, soon after injury, within 4 hours, the OCT4 is induced. But interesting to note, by 12 hours, it is come back somewhat close to the normal state. What it suggests that mammalian retina also, after an injury, is trying to repair. It is inducing, but something is preventing it. That means the intention is right, but it is failing to do so. And what are the factors that is causing? That is interesting to pursue. So because of this reason, probably the mammalian retina or mouse retina is incapable of regenerating perfectly. So this OCT4 also, when you knock them down, you can see a decreased knocking down using morpholina, you see a decrease in the proliferating cell, which suggests that this induction is essential for the normal regeneration to happen. And this is their counting, that is the quantitative analysis. And one important point to keep in mind is that earlier I told you the delta node signaling, which is a anti, like I told you that normally if 100 cells are required for regeneration to happen, normally cell don't want, or this tissue don't want to produce 1,000 cells because it is a wastage of resources. So the delta node signaling makes sure that the retina do not produce more than 200 cells and remain. So 100 is used and 100 is excess, and those extra 100 will be degraded by apoptosis. But you don't want 1,000 cells to be formed. So this delta node signaling is doing its job via a mediator called HER4.1. So normally, soon after injury, a HER4.1 also is induced heavily. And if you knock the OCT4 down, you saw a decrease in the proliferation, but you saw a significant decrease in the HER4.1 expression also. And we saw the HER4.1 promoter is bound by OCT4. It can directly bind, and we confirmed it by CHIP assay. But that's not it. Normally, in mammalian system, what is shown that OCT4 can stimulate the production of some of these microRNA such as MIR-200 and also MIR-141, etc. And they remain in clusters. So OCT4 can stimulate. But what we found, if you knock them down, instead of finding a decrease in them, we rather saw an increase in them. So this gave us some valuable clues. So what this molecule might be doing it. So maybe the OCT4 is influencing them in zebrafish in a different manner. So we confirmed it further that they do have OCT4 binding site, but it is working in a different manner, similar to what we saw in the case of LINT28. So it can influence the expression of MIR-200 in not same to that of what is seen in mammals or in humans. It is something different, although it has binding site. So we were curious how this is happening, but we confirmed it that by chromatin immunoprecipitation, that this promoter is functional and it indeed is occupied by the OCT4. And the same site, when you pull down using HDAC, because HDAC we know, which is a negative regulator, we have seen it. So HDAC can also occupy the same site, which suggests that probably OCT4 and HDAC are occupying together and influencing in a different manner. So what we did that we tried overexpressing to prove this further, whether the downregulation of OCT4 is negatively regulating, then upregulation should show a positive regulation. We used different concentrations of OCT4 and we saw a somewhat parabolic expression. That means when you keep increasing up to certain level, the number of proliferating cell increases and then it starts decreasing. And we were confused what this result is showing us. Then we went into the literature and we saw somewhat similar study has been shown in OCT4, that different levels of OCT4, high levels, remember soon after injury in mouse as well as in fish, it is quite high. The OCT4 level is very high and that is important in the initiation of reprogramming. And then the level comes down and it is important in the recycling. And when it is very low, it is helpful in the differentiation. So that suggests that different concentration does different jobs. So when you start with a low concentration, you are somewhat here. And once you go, it will either go to this stage or this stage. So that might be the reason that we find a parabolic expression. Not only that, we also look what is the level of, this is a co-immunoprecipitation. I will explain it elaborately, that this is a anti-HDAC antibody probe. Okay, that means you have used antibody against HDAC1, but it is different stages of injury. Uninjured, 15 hour, that is soon after injury, and then 4 day, where the peak of proliferation, and 7 day, that is towards fag end of proliferation. And then this is the input control, that is normal lysed sample. As you can see here, that the level of they don't show the same, they vary because it's a total extract, and this is the negative control. But what is interesting is you have done, one is OCT4 pull down, and then there is HDAC1 pull down. So as you see towards the fag end of, that is 7 dpi, you see an increased collaboration of OCT4 and HDAC to push some of the cell in the opposite direction. That means not reprogramming, but rather in a differentiation manner. Although the level of HDAC is low here, but you can see they are more associated with the OCT4 towards it. That means when you have too much of protein, it do not have any too much of affinity, because very high level of HDAC is there, because that is quite early stage. But towards the late stage, although the level of HDAC is decreasing, it has got higher and higher affinity towards the OCT4 to drive a different set of genes. That is how OCT4 different level is contributing to such a unique way of cell proliferation. So what we can understand, OCT4 is influencing HER4, that is via delta node signaling. And then also it can influence a factor ACL1A, which I did not discuss because of time constraint, but which is an essential molecule that is important for retina regeneration. So these studies are published here. So those who are interested can read. And then comes the last part, that is the TGF beta signaling. That is a developmental pathway similar to that of sonic hedgehog signaling. And what we did, we wanted to study what is the role of this pathway during retina regeneration. Like sonic hedgehog signaling is important during development. TGF beta signaling also is important during development. But then there is a catch. We have to understand, in mammals, by default, the TGF beta signaling is anti-proliferative, except in the case of cancer. If a normal organism gets cancer, the TGF beta signaling is pro-proliferative. But by default, TGF beta signaling is anti-proliferative, means it do not allow too much of proliferation. But during zebrafish retina regeneration, if you block the TGF beta signaling using two different drugs, you see a dose-dependent decrease in the proliferating cell. Whether you use perfenidone or you use this SP431542 drug, you see a dose-dependent decrease. And the opposite side is seen if you put the TGF beta protein. So this is for negatively influencing the TGF beta signaling. This is for positively influencing the TGF beta signaling. So this gave us some clue that this is somewhat similar to that of cancerous condition, probably. Now, we saw if you deliver TGF beta protein, you increase the dose of a pro-proliferative factors such as ACL1A, LIN28, SOX2, and OCT4. So these are essential molecules for regeneration. So we can assume that TGF beta protein is a facilitator of proliferation, and this is a Western blot to confirm that. So what it is contributing, the TGF beta signaling is influencing ACL1A, is influencing LIN28, and it can influence the OCT4 and then stimulate these pathways also. So this study is published in this article. Those who are interested can read for more details. And our future directions in the lab is to understand the epigenome during the regeneration in a holistic way, because having genes is not the essential factor, but rather how to regulate it. It is just like you have a fabulous tool with you doesn't mean that you will become a great sculptor or a great having a nice pen doesn't become you will become a great artist or a writer, but how to use it is important. So epigenome contributes to it, and we also planning to do a comparative study of regeneration among fin, heart and retina of the zebrafish, and also we are exploring the chromatin dynamics during retina regeneration, because all these factors decides which gene to what extent should be expressed in the retina for the regeneration. That means starting is not enough, stopping also is equally important. So then I have two more slides just to show, we all know that during diabetes, our regeneration is compromised. We know that if anyone who gets diabetes, you end up getting diabetic ulcer, they damage their tissue. Means basically organ failure is a feature of diabetes, right? So we looked whether if we can induce diabetes in fish, what happened to the retina regeneration? So what we did two kinds of diabetes. One is type 2, which is very prevalent one. That is a lifestyle disease. And another is type 1 disease. That is type 1 diabetes. That is prevention of insulin production. That is your beta cells of pancreas stop producing insulin. You end up getting diabetes. That is type 1 diabetes. Type 2 diabetes, insulin resistance, means body is not responding to insulin, which comes from a lifestyle disease. So this can be induced by overfeeding the fish by multiple times a day, and then other methods is feeding them with sucrose or you dip them in glucose. So in a normal animal, fasting glucose level is around 42 milligram per deciliter. Ours is around 80 to 120 humans. But whereas in zebrafish, it is normally around 40 in and around 40 milligram per deciliter. But in overfed one, type 2 diabetes, you end up getting 70, almost double of that. Other methods include 178 and then 184. In type 1 diabetes, when insulin is missing, it goes as high as 370 to 327. So these are all fasting level. So we looked for what happens to its regeneration. So this is the normal controlled retina. And here sucrose fed, and this is type 1 diabetes. You significantly reduce the number. So this we did out of our curiosity to show how can diabetes influence the regeneration capacity. Is it similar to that of in mammals? And the answer is yes. Both retina as well as fin. In control, the fin after amputation, it grows nicely. Whereas in hyperglycemic animal, it is significantly reduced. Although some proliferation occurs, but it is far from complete. So here I stop my talk. I would like to acknowledge. So today's work is mainly from my lab's postdoc, Dr. Poonam Sharma, and two students who passed out of the lab. That is Simran and also Saumitra. And these are other members. And this is Saumitra, this is Poonam, and this is Simran. So I presented their work, and the cell transplantation work is done by Mansi. So I also thank Wellcome Trust DBT India Alliance for my early stage of my research, and ICER Mohali and DBT, and also DST for their generous funding support. If there is any questions, I will be happy to take.
Thank you, Rajesh. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
It is now open for questions. Whoever is on Zoom, if you have a question, you can use the raise hand feature. We will also keep checking on the YouTube to see if there are any questions. So Rajesh, let me ask you a very naive question.
No problem.
So what would determine, in some sense, evolutionarily speaking, whether a given organism will have a high degree of regenerative ability or a fairly low degree of regenerative ability? If there were a few features, one could say, okay, these are the major contributing factors.
Yes. So it's an interesting question. It's actually one of the holy grail questions, I can say, that in mammals, higher order animals, they lack the ability to handle, they lack the ability to handle infections. Like if there is a wound, if there is a damage, they are vulnerable for infection. Although they have advanced immune system, their innate immunity is quite poor. Because of which, what happens? They end up getting infections. To protect, what they do is they heal the wound as quick as possible, because wound healing is fast and regeneration is slow. Whereas these lower vertebrates, or which is primitive vertebrates, they can handle their infection quite efficiently because of innate immunity is quite strong. So this makes probably that they can buy extra time to regenerate. But there will be other contributing factors also, that the level epigenetic changes that is occurring in this animal, whether the gene is turned on efficiently and stayed turned on. So these things might be regulated at a genetic level. But in all animals, the intention is very clear. Soon after injury, the regeneration is one of the early alternative the animal is exploring. But it is believed that the inability to handle the infection could be one of the reasons. And there is one more line of thoughts that is emerging, is that the advanced immune system in these mammals can negatively influence these progenitor cells. The cells that is formed may not survive efficiently, because your immune system see them as foreign body, and they can attack them, and because they have too much refined, any newly formed cell can be targeted. So instead, a fibroblast is an easy alternative. And above all, the supreme intelligence, or the mammals are more adapted or fit to live. So that allows them, even if an organ is disabled, they can live. Say if a mammal has lost one eye, nothing happens. But for us, a aquatic animal or fish, it is a death sentence. Unless it is regenerating, or any damage that is occurring, if it doesn't fix it. But a terrestrial animal, they are less vulnerable for other troubles as in an aquatic animal, because aquatic, the vision is very limited. So they are vulnerable for attack and infection and other troubles. But infection, they handle with their innate immunity. But the exact reason, nobody knows, because every genes required for regeneration is present in mammals also. But the way in which it is expressed is what is contributing, probably.
Okay. So, one more question from me before we take questions from YouTube. There are a few questions from there also.
Yeah.
And if anybody on Zoom has a question, please raise your hand before I ask my question. I shouldn't be hogging all the questions. Okay, since I don't see any hand, I will use this privilege. I'm going to ask one more question. So if you look at regeneration as a character and look at the evolutionary history of life, is there some way of saying whether this regeneration is a derived character? That is, most organisms, if you look at evolutionary history, were not very good at regenerating, whereas now some of them have become evolved this ability to regenerate. Or everybody was good at regenerating, and over evolutionary time, some of us have lost the ability to regenerate. So
most likely the second option, what you said, at some time point, we lost the ability, because a mammal, there is a South American mammal, I forgot, a mouse, which can regenerate its skin. Skin means not along with the dermis, like in its back of its body. That was published recent 2 years ago in Nature. That was the one and only reported case. A mammal can regenerate at least some tissue structure.
No.
It is believed that regeneration was there and it is lost in some lineage. And that was, you can't go. That is why fishes and frogs have got extreme regenerative capacity, whereas reptiles have got very minimum, whereas birds, embryonic stage, it can regenerate. And one more factor is that as the animal is growing, its epigenome gets more and more get hypermethylated. Like even in mammals, in embryonic stage, inside the embryo, it can regenerate. Like inside the womb or very early stage, it can regenerate. But once it is born out, birds can regenerate for a few days. But after, as the days are passing, your ability to, and that is so in fishes also. If the fish is very old, regeneration is happening, but it's a very slow rate. So although it is quite good in, you know, breeding and other things, it is other activities are happening, but it's not that typical age-related symptom. But as more and more cell division is occurring, probably something is happening to its genome. That genome means epigenome, not to the sequence. Most likely, evolutionary point of view, we had this character in all the ancestors, but somehow, in some lineage of evolution, this character is lost, but gained some other character, somehow it is lost in the mammals. But however, we have ability to regenerate liver, which is a complex organ that is present in all animals. Probably because if you cannot regenerate liver, it is a death sentence, because liver is one of the most complex organ that if it is not regenerating because of the toxins and other, it also does other functions also. That's why if liver fails, you cannot, even if heart is not there, you can make a person live using extra outside pump. May not be for long, but if liver gives up, there is no way. You cannot supply the products of liver in any means. So liver normally regenerates. I think if 80% of the liver is damaged, from the remaining 20%, the liver can grow back in all animals. But in in other organs, when it comes to other organs, probably because of the intelligence, the extreme intelligence mammals and birds have compared to fishes and frogs, probably allowed them to adapt much better, probably. But it is, regeneration is considered an ancient feature. Like even insects have the ability, like insects can regenerate their damaged, especially in larval stage. Yeah.
So there are two questions from YouTube. The first one is from Surabhi Garg, who says, what is the importance of transparent embryos with respect to zebrafish, I guess?
See, transparent embryo, it is basically a feature during development point of view. Transparent embryos will be spotted less by the predators. So it is a evolutionary advantage. But by around 24 hours, it develops pigments. So it is helpful for us to do embryonic studies during embryonic development. Other than that, it doesn't have any huge relevance. Say it's a feature. Yeah.
Shriza Rai has a question. She asks, being exothermic, does regenerative pathway get or could get affected by the external factors like temperature and other things in fishes?
It can. Definitely the temperature, because in general, low temperature, these are all poikilothermic animals. The environment decides their body temperature, means, or we also call them cold-blooded animal. And they live typically in the 25, 26 compared to 37 of mammals. So probably its enzymatic activity is quite slow, not too fast. Hence, it gets at a slower rate rather than riding your vehicle at 100 km per hour versus 50 km per hour. So it might be a contributing factor, because high temperature by 35, 37 degree in zebrafish, the heat shock proteins will turn on. Whereas in mammals, it is a normal body temperature. Same with the frogs also. There's also low body temperature. Reptiles also. Only birds and mammals can regulate their body temperature. Yeah. But it will. It could be an important factor that is contributing. Yeah.
I guess we have asked all the questions that were there. So I would like to thank Rajesh. Thank you very much. That was a very fascinating talk. Thanks. It's always interesting to see how these special characters are present in some animals and not in all of us. Some things that we would like to have, but we don't.
But it's a goal, actually. Yeah. That is the goal. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the talk. I would like to thank all our viewers, both here on Zoom and on YouTube, for joining us. We will be announcing another talk for this month very soon, so please look out. I'd like to thank my colleagues, Amit and Mahua, who are handling everything behind the scenes. Thank you so much. Thank you. We'll see you.